guys, it's me, Jackie. I'm going to bring to you some PTSD video and some information for those of you who have family who just returned from the war or returned a while back. Also, I'm going to be sharing with you some of my experiences. Okay, so where do I begin? The whole reason I deployed in the first place, I volunteered. Because the place that I live has the lowest job market in the country. And basically here where I live, it's agriculture and retail. And I don't do either one of those things. I'm a construction supervisor. I am in charge of people who run heavy equipment. I know how to run everything from scrapers to dozers to graders, loaders. I can't run the crane. I don't like the crane. That's why I have a good soldier that did that for me while we were in Afghanistan. I have 15 years of service in the United States Army, mostly United States Army National Guard. I'd say 13 out of those 15 years were active duty, and I spent a big, huge majority of that time working down on the U.S.-Mexican border to ensure that the fence was up and the road was done and all that cool jazz that was so important a couple years ago but now has lost its edge in the American society. People don't really care about that border anymore. And while I'm venting, I might as well just continue. they spent close to 90 billion dollars for a civilian contractor to come down and build it, when they were only paying the United States government or the National Guard $7 million a year to maintain with flexibility. Any of you civilian contractors out there, you know, you go from point A to point B, and that's all you do. And you pay me, and I'm gone. That's the way it works in the civilian world. But when you're military, you give the United States government or you give a certain entity $7 million, and you have the flexibility to move them anywhere along the U.S.-Mexican border you so choose. And it's kind of an active force there. But they did away with it, that being said. Alright, so, I joined the military in 1996. My main purpose was to provide good health care for my son and stability for myself with a good income. That was the whole reason I did it. To get out of the fast food market up in South Dakota, I worked at a place called Taco John's, and I enjoyed it, but it just wasn't cutting it for me and my kid. So I joined the military. From there, I moved to a couple different states and then ended up down in San Diego working along the border. From there, I got deployed to Iraq in 2004-05. I went to Iraq, man, I was in my early 30s, you know, and I thought, wow, this is going to be fun. I get to go to a new country, I get to be part of this war, and, you know, I couldn't wait to get over there. Like, I wasn't really young then, but like all the younger people, I wanted to get over there and see some action, see some bombs, and see some things go off, and get a chance to perhaps, you know, take out an enemy or two. That's what I wanted to do. Then I went over to Iraq, and I realized war isn't all it's cracked up to be, at least not for some MOSs, which are your specialty skills that you have. If you're an 11 Bang Bang, which is the guys that run around and they go out seeking the enemy, if you're into that kind of stuff, you probably enjoy it. But I myself went over there as a mechanic, and the majority of my year I spent on base. Fixing all the equipment as it would come in from outside the wire and repairing it and making sure it got right back out into the fight. But on certain occasions when they were desperate and they needed somebody, I think it was probably 3 or 4 occasions that was like that. Mostly civil affairs where we'd go out and they'd hand out stuff to children and put up signs and go talk to people, you know, PSYOPs kind of stuff. They needed security, so I would volunteer for that, just anything to get myself off the base. If you've never been overseas, being on a base that is probably the size, I don't know, sometimes they're only about 5 or 6 square blocks, if that, for an entire year. It's like being in prison. Because all you do is you eat, you work, you go to sleep, and that's it. That's all there is to it. Well, we went out a couple times on that. I was lucky, because it was 05, and they were doing the elections at that time. So I got to go and be a part of the elections, the very first elections for Iraq. And that was when I first experienced any kind of mishap. That and going down to Baghdad, we had to go and up armor some equipment, because that was back in the days when we didn't have any up armor. All we had was, we called it the hillbilly armor. It was just this real thin, you know, plate of steel with a little opening so you could put your weapon through. That's all it was. When I went down on that one, I experienced a suicide, a vehicle-borne suicide attempt. Well, it wasn't so successful for him, but it was for us. It's hard for me to talk about this, you guys, because to me, that was the most dramatic experience in my career up until that point. And we're going down to Baghdad, and they're going up, and he had his hood up on the side of the road, and decided he was going to blow himself up and blow us up along with him. And luckily, he blew himself up at a time when there was no vehicles of ours close to him, so he basically just blew himself up and no one else. But he was separated. His lower half of his body was nowhere to be found, but his upper half of his body, from his lower abdomen up, was on the other side of the road. And we watched it fly across the road. It's quite a thing to see, that kind of thing. And meanwhile, we're surrounded by hundreds and hundreds of Iraqis on both sides of the road. And the only thing to defend us was an old M16 and a pistol, a 9mm. That's all we had. But we got moving. We got moving after that. It took me a while. I couldn't do things like, I couldn't eat spaghetti. As simple as it sounds, I couldn't eat spaghetti. I couldn't eat a lot of things. I couldn't do a lot of things. Explosions would go off and I would jump quite easily. Although the FOB that I was at was FOB Warrior up in Kirkuk, Iraq. That's also known as IED Alley to some people out there. that they put an expressway in for the base for IEDs, but that's beside the point. But we were constantly being bombarded. That's the base. If you look on YouTube and you type in Kirkuk, Iraq, ammunition explosion. That went on for a couple hours, and that was a little prior to me arriving there, but we got bombarded constantly with mortars over there. I got so used to it that as soon as I could hear it being fired off outside the wire, I would take cover. Before it would even fly over and hit, I would take cover. Before the sirens went off, I was in the bunker. I was done. You know, I got so good at that.